It's a lot of pressure. I tell you, I like Christmas. I tell you, singing Mighty Warrior, now that's the way to celebrate Christmas. That was awesome. What a great song. Can you turn me down just a little bit, Jess, please? Thank you. Well, thank you for sharing your story. And Ms. Paula, thank you for sharing your story. And your stories aren't done yet. You know, God's still writing your story, and it's going to be an awesome story. Look forward to hearing more. I know that there's other people in this room, too, that have some amazing stories to tell. And I know we don't have all night, but I know that my buddy Robbie, I don't even know where he ran off to, but I could probably hand him the microphone. He could talk for a little while about some things in his life. I know my brother Greg right there could probably do the same kind of thing. Got a brother in town right here, Gavin. Say hello to Gavin. He's my brother in the Lord. He's a good man. Gavin Gavino, yeah. It's good to see him. A lot of us have stories to tell. Mine took 134,000 words, but it's not unique by any means. God is at work in all of our lives, isn't he? He's doing some amazing things. Well, tonight we're wrapping up our Christmas series. We're here. We're gathered tonight to celebrate, really not just a little baby in a barn, but to celebrate God's love for us. I think that's been, and we didn't even plan that. It's just kind of been the way the night has unfolded. We're here to, like I said, to celebrate God's love and to celebrate God's good news for all people. The coming of the much anticipated Messiah, the Christ child sent to take away the sins of mankind and to restore the creative order back to its original state. It's a big thing, this Christmas thing. It's a big thing, and I think it's a lot bigger than we make it to be. Although Christmas is the most celebrated holiday in the world, I still don't think that it's celebrated to the level that it should be. We hear the Christmas story every year, but it's bigger than shepherds and magi, and it's bigger than Santa Claus, and bigger than family vacations and family gatherings and Black Friday shopping and discounts at the store and your best toy and your best dinner. It's in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And it goes on to say that the Word put on flesh and came and dwelt with us. It's Emmanuel, God with us. That's what this holiday is all about. It's all about that. God stepping into humanity and to start this epic revolution, a revolution that would span the globe and touch the lives of everyone on this planet. I mentioned earlier in the video, and it's worth mentioning again about this revolution, and really what it is when Jesus came down and was born into the stable, it's great to rejoice about this. It's great to celebrate God coming to be with his people, but really what it was all about, it was to initiate God's plan from before the creation of the earth to redeem back his people and to give us a new way to live, a sudden and momentous shift in the status quo. That's what a revolution is all about. And it's an extreme or complete change in the way that you live your life. And so, again, revolting. People have asked me for the last couple weeks, why in the world are you calling this holiday revolting? Well, it's not revolting as in a descriptive word, the adjective of you are disgusting and you are wrong and you are ugly and you stink. It's not that at all. It's the verb. It's the action. See, Jesus came to start a revolution. So for those of us that are involved in this, revolting means it's the person who is actually rising in rebellion. It's the person who is revolting who says, no more, no more to the authorities of Satan and his world. He has created a world system that is here to kill, steal, and destroy you. And Jesus came that night in Bethlehem to initiate a new way for you to live, something totally different. So the one who is revolting is the one who is actively participating in the revolution. And in this case, like I said, refusing to acknowledge the authority of someone. In this case, of course, who is this? It's Satan. It's the enemy of your soul, the one who loathes you and wants to hurt you, who wants to destroy your family, who wants to destroy your marriage, who wants to destroy your health, who wants to destroy your church, who wants to destroy your reputation. He wants to destroy everything in your life. And the system that he oversees and runs is the world system, filled with lies and deception, and you should live this way, and you should live that way. And it's filled with all these empty promises and unreasonable standards that drive us to death. And so Jesus comes, and he looks across the landscape of all of society, to the religious and the non-religious, and he says, listen, everyone. As a matter of fact, he talked to the religious even more. He says, you're all doing it wrong. See, the religious people, they really got underneath his skin because they thought that if they made a bunch of rules up and the apex of religious success was behavioral conditioning and order and correction and I could be better, behavior modification. Just do this prayer and do this certain times a week and you'll be fine. And Jesus is like, no, man, you miss the whole point. It's not your way. I want to give you a completely new way to live. That's why Christmas. That's why the stable. That's why Bethlehem. Do you guys, some of you are old enough like I, to remember the 1989 film, The Field of Dreams? Who remembers that movie? What's that? Yeah, but you're a baseball guy. I kind of thought, you've never seen Field of Dreams? It's a baseball movie. And an awesome one, right? Awesome one, right? So it's the story of Ray Kinsella. Ray Kinsella is is an Iowa farmer, and he's got cornfields, and he's got apparently a childhood that's not exactly perfect. Anyone? Dad's not the greatest in the world. Anyone, right? So his dad apparently was a negligent dad. He played semi-pro baseball, and baseball was big in his family. Big in your family, right? Okay. And so he's out there one time in his cornfield. It's been a long time since I've seen this, but he's out there in the cornfield, and all of a sudden he hears this voice, and it's just this whisper. And he says, the voice says, if you build it, he will come. Not they. That's what everyone says, but that's not what it says. If you build it, he will come. He's like freaking out, right? You know, when you guys hear the voice, it freaks you out too, right? You hear the voice? See, a lot of people misquote that movie. They go, you know what? I'm going to open up a fishing tackle store in the middle of the desert because if you build it, they will come. Yeah, that's dumb, right? See, you got to have the voice. You have to hear the voice, right? You got to hear the voice. You got to have God tell you something or else it's just stupid. So here's the voice. And so what he does is he starts to carve out in his cornfield the shape of a baseball field. And everyone thinks he's crazy, which I guess people thought Noah was crazy. I get it. Well, you wouldn't believe what happens. I hate to spoil it if you haven't watched the movie, but he builds this thing, and guess what? He comes. These old dead baseball players from back in the day start showing up in his field. They start walking out of the cornfields, including his father. His father, right? His father shows up as a young man, as a baseball player, and these guys start playing baseball in his field. That was pretty awesome. And so him and his family and a couple people, they sit out there every day and these people show up and they're playing baseball. And that was impacting for Ray Kinsella. It impacted his life. He got to speak to his father, right? It's pretty cool. And it was impacting to those few people that saw what was going on inside the walls of the cornfield. But what's What's really interesting is at the end of the movie, and I want you to watch the movie, I think you'll love it. But at the end of the movie, what happens is that the camera is on the field again, and it starts to come back up out of the field. It's at night. And it starts to go from in tight, close, to bird's eye. And what the people inside the field don't see, you begin to see. As the camera comes up, you can see to the horizon and the line of cars with their lights on, as far as the eye could see, are coming to see what's going on there. It was amazing. And the point of I'm trying to make is that the people inside the cornfield, like, to them it was a big deal, but they couldn't see the bigger picture. They couldn't see the impact of what was going on there. And I think that's the way it is with us, with Christmas. I think Christmas itself, which is to celebrate the birth of Jesus, even the holiday itself veils the impact and the weight of exactly what's really going on. We get so wrapped up in our shopping. We get so wrapped up in our church service. We get so wrapped up in our family gathering. We get so wrapped up in Santa Claus and Rudolph and buying the right gift and traveling to go see family. We get so wrapped up in the little thing that we're doing to celebrate our little Christmas that we miss the point of this revolution that God started 2,000 years ago. It's amazing what is going on. It is amazing what he has done. Jesus Christ, God in flesh, comes to earth to set us free and start a new way of living. That is Christmas. That is Christmas, and that's what we are to celebrate. Now, if you're here tonight to get any high theology, you came to the wrong church, because that's not what I'm going to do. You can come back another time for that. Tonight, I want to take the believer to a place of affirmation. I want to take you, if you've said yes to Jesus, I want you to walk out of here so confident in your choice to follow Christ, greater than you've ever felt before. And if you're not a believer, I want you to go, you know what? Maybe this Jesus thing is good. Maybe I'll give it a crack. Listen, we all of us that are spiritual, we all want you to repent of sin and embrace Christ. And you know, well, maybe that's not where you are. Maybe you just like have no faith. Maybe you don't know what to believe because there's all kinds of stuff and you're bombarded with these different options. I want you to hear some info tonight that's going to make it like, no doubt, I have to follow Jesus. It's got to be the right way. It's got to be the right way. If it's a revolution, it has to be powerful, right? That's a powerful word, isn't it? Revolution. It's not just a speed bump. It's a revolution. And a revolution has to be lasting and big, right? It has to be lasting. You know, see, when Jesus was roaming the earth and all these religious folks wanting to kill him and everything, there's this part of the Bible where they don't know what to do. No one knows what to do with Jesus, right? None of us know what to do with Jesus. He's a weird guy, man. He's interesting. He's different than any of us. And he washes people's feet, and he cooks them food, and he's God of heaven and earth, and it freaks us out, right? So they don't know what to do with him, and so they want to crucify him, but then they kind of maybe I'll kill him, but maybe I won't, because if I do, then people are going to be upset because I don't know what to, right? And so this one dude comes on. He's like, hey, listen. He starts talking about these other people that kind of rose up in the past, and they're like, well, remember that one guy, and he thought he was something special, but that kind of died out. No big deal. And then there was this other guy, and he had some followers, but then he kind of petered out too. But listen, if this Jesus is really of God, if you mess with him, you're messing with God, and you need to step off. So here's the thing. We have to see, he said, that, well, I'm saying this is a revolution. He said that all your ways are wrong. Here's a new way. I want to try to prove to you tonight that the revolution is real. And that he's made a lasting impact in this world. Otherwise, it's just another speed bump, another person to be ignored. So I want to go over a couple of things with you just to see if he's really made any impact in this world. Who's a Harry Potter fan? Anyone? You can raise your hand in church. It's okay. We're not going to witch hunt you. Little Harry Potter, woo. Okay, you can be honest. You're doing it anyway. God can see you stinking sinners, right? Yeah. Okay, who's ever read the Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. Anyone have read that? One person. It was a biggie. It was a big book. It was back in 1997. It sold, listen to this. Listen, I was excited. I got a royalty check from my book a couple months ago for 48 cents.
Yeah!
Yeah. Best-selling author, buddy. That's right. Right? This book right here, Harry Potter, it sold 107 million copies. That's a lot of copies, right? Yeah, it's not the biggest one. Here's one that's even bigger. Who's a Lord of the Rings fan? Come on now. Nobody? Yeah, Lord of the Rings. All of them. They're all good, right?
Precious.
The Lord of the Rings, J.R.R. Tolkien, he wrote this book a long time ago. Don't know the date, but it sold 150 million copies. Big. That's not the biggest. You ever hear of Tale of Two Cities by Charles Dickens? What's Charles Dickens' famous Christmas movie? Christmas Carol? The Ghost of Christmas Past, Christmas Future, Christmas Present, or whatever? You old people know that one. I don't. 200 million copies it sold. 200 million copies. There's another one that trumps that, though. And anyone know who Chairman Mao is? Chairman Mao, he wrote a book called Little Red Book. He was the leader of communist China back in the 40s, 50s, 60s, right? And he wrote a book called The Little Red Book. He trumps all those books. Listen, he sold, this is crazy, 1 billion, say it with me, go ahead, put your finger right here. Go ahead, come on. 1 billion copies. He sold a lot of books, but here's the thing with him. He stacked the deck because he's an evil dictator. He can do it, right? It was required reading for every student. You had to buy it and you had to read it or you're dead, right? Stacking the deck. He made you read it. 1 billion copies. That's a lot, right? Say, that's a lot. That's a lot of books. Listen, there's another book. There's another book, and look, I'm trying to prove the revolution of Jesus is impacting. There's a book, and in that book, there's a phrase, there's one verse in John 5:39, and Jesus said that the scriptures, hold up the scriptures, that every, look, that right there. What's your favorite verse?
John 3:16.
Yeah, points to Jesus. What's your favorite verse? Do you have one? Do you have a favorite verse? What is it? Hosea 6, that points to Jesus. Well, yeah, I know what your one is.
1 Corinthians 10:31.
Guess who it points to? Come on now. Jesus.
Nehemiah 8:10.
The scriptures, Jesus said all the scriptures from Genesis to Revelation all point to Jesus Christ. And that book has sold, according to the Guinness Book of World Records, 5 billion copies. 5 billion copies. Answer.com, this is the internet, so we don't know. Ask.com said that they've sold 3.9 billion Bibles, and listen, in 500 known languages. There's another one, Yahoo Answers. Don't know if these are accurate. It says that there's over 6 billion Bibles have been sold. But listen, that's just sold. Did you ever go to a hotel? And who's ever been to a hotel? What's on the nightstand? Yeah, the King James Bible that none of us read, but it's there, right? Jerome and Tim. By the way, I have to tell you, okay, that never looks good. I just want you to know that right from the giddy up, okay? I love you, but that never looks good. Listen, listen. There are organizations across the globe that mass produce the Bible by the thousands and Daryl Barrett's a friend of mine. He lives in Georgia. He's here sometimes. He's part of the Southern Baptist Convention Disaster Relief. They go across the country into other nations, and they hand out like 60 and 70,000 Bibles permission trip. I watched on listen, these are amazing books, The Tale of Two Cities and Lord of the Rings and Harry Potter and Yao Ming and all these different awesome guys, right? You go on YouTube and you could see video after video of people in these remote countries when all of a sudden here come the missionaries with cases of Bible and they grab the Bibles and they're crying and they're kissing their Bible and they're praising God. They're going crazy because they got a copy of God's word, which is truth and life. No other book does that. No other book on the planet has ever done that, ever. Okay, that's just one thing. That's just one thing. God's book, it's by far, okay, if you double, okay, two times is double, three times is triple. If you sell four times as many, it's quadruple. Five? How about six times? You just said sex in church. Now no one can blame me because you always are on me about it. Mary did. Yeah, we all know I say it. Okay, so that's the first thing. How about that's God's book. How about God the person? How about God the person? Do you know that there's 7 billion people in the world right now? 7 billion people. That's a lot of people. Right? But that's just right now. What about 100 years ago? How many people were there? I don't know. You can Google it, right? How about 100 years before that? And 100 years before that? 100 years before that? Okay, so it gets kind of tough to decide how many people there are. So again, we're going to go online. We don't really know. You know, none of us were there since the beginning. Let's just go to the best that we can. Okay, we go online and you write, how many people have ever lived? And so website after website after website. Don't know where they gather this data, but let's just use it for our conversation. It is believed the best average number, and it's actually, when you go online, you know you get these big, huge gaps between facts usually on websites. This one's pretty much the same. People, the experts believe that there's been 107 billion people on this earth. That's a lot of people, isn't it? Do you know how many 107 billion is? No, you don't. You don't know how much 107 billion is. 107 billion is more than the brain can even fathom. It's huge amounts of people. So let me just do this. I did a little math because I know some of you are weirdos. So here's 107 billion. Who knows what the Goodyear blimp is? Right? You seen the Goodyear blimp? Okay, there's a couple of different Goodyear blimps. But you got ants in your pants, bruh? All right, sit down. Thanks. You're distracting me. Thank you. I love you, Zach. It's good to see you again. All right, so here's the thing. The Goodyear blimp, there's a variety of different sizes, but the average is about 192 feet long. It's a big, huge balloon, right? It's huge. The Goodyear blimp, inside the balloon, it's a big balloon. This building's 4,700 square feet. Who has a house here that's this big? No, big place, right? Right? It's 4,700 square feet. But that's different than cubic feet. Cubic volume is different than square feet. Cubic volume is all this air right here, right? From wall to wall, from ceiling to floor in the entire building. That's a lot of cubic feet, right? So in the Goodyear blimp, there's 202,700 cubic feet in interior volume of this big balloon. That's a big balloon, would you agree? 200,700 cubic square feet. Okay, you know how many, you guys know what this is, right? This is just a baseball. I don't know why baseball is on the radar tonight. I don't even like baseball, okay? Do you know how many baseballs it would take to fill the Goodyear blimp? 12.9 million. 12.9 million baseballs, okay? 12.9 million baseballs. You want to know how much 107 billion is? That's 8.2 million Goodyear blimps lined up from nose to tail across this horizon. Each of them filled with 12.9 million baseballs. That's how many people have lived on this earth since it was created. But let me ask you a question. I want to ask you, what do Elvis and Madonna and Michael Jackson and Hitler and Napoleon and George Washington and Martin Luther King and Tiger Woods and Bill Gates and Donald Trump, what do they all have in common? Okay, you know what they have in common? I can't hear you all. No, that they're not the most famous person who's ever lived. Okay? He's not, then none of them the most famous person that's ever lived. If you just go online and just simply ask Siri, who's the most famous person ever? The first website comes up. Guess who's on top? Jesus Christ. The second one, The second one is spineless. They won't mention any religious people, okay? So they're spineless. You can't even go with that one. The third one, Yahoo Answers, guess who's on top? Yeah, Jesus Christ. How about answers.com? Guess. So smart. Okay, you know Time Magazine back in 2013, they did an article in their magazine, and they said, who is the most significant, 107 billion people, okay? 107 billion people. Who's the most significant human being to ever live? Where is it? Where's the picture? No. Where's the picture? It's a picture of Time Magazine. Okay, all the way down the list. It's not in the verses. It's not in the verses. Okay, anyway, it was a picture of Time Magazine, and there you go. Who's the most significant figure in history? Listen. You might be the most significant person in this row. That would be impressive, honestly. Listen, seriously. That would be awesome, right? If he was the most significant person in this row, that'd be big, because there's some powerhouses right here, right? How about in this side of the church, if he was the most significant guy? Yeah. Actually, Christianity is about humility. You'll learn someday. Okay? Okay, if he was the most significant person on this side of the room, that would be big, because there's some real power hitters over here, man, right? Power hitters, right? Okay, but what if that would be impressive. What if he was the most significant person in this whole church? Like, that would be a big thing too. Okay, 8.2 million Goodyear blimps, each filled with 12.9 million baseballs. That's 107 billion people that have walked the earth. And of all the people that have ever walked the earth, this one dude who was a part-time carpenter and a rabbi who only had a ministry for 3 years and hung out with 12 people 6,500 miles away from here, he is the most significant person who's ever walked the face of the earth. That's Jesus Christ the Lord. I said earlier that Christmas is the most observed holiday on the planet, and I sort of lied, because New Year's Eve is, but you have to celebrate that. You don't have a choice, do you? Right? It's just coming. It doesn't matter if you're Buddhist or Christian. It doesn't make any difference. You are subject to the flip of the calendar. You got no choice, right? Okay, but here's the thing. Christmas, other than that, Christmas is the most popular. But New Year's Eve, you know what? That's popular. That's very, very popular. And here's the thing about New Year's Eve. New Year's is a way of measuring time. The calendar is a way of measuring time, right? Okay. Even that, Jesus Christ is the Lord of the calendar. Do you understand? We're in Eustis. What's today's date? December 26th, okay? Yeah. And we're all Christians, right? Right? Well, some of you, I don't know, some of you might not be. It's fine, whatever. I hope you are someday, okay? But you know, do whatever you want. But I really hope that you are. That'll be, if you're a believer, if you agree with me, say amen.
Amen!
Yeah, okay, yeah. Would you, if they'd made a decision for Christ tonight, would you love on them and care for them?
Yes,
yes. Okay. So it's December 26th here in Christian Little Eustis, isn't it? Guess what? In Afghanistan, it's 99.8% Muslim. Do you know that? Not many Christians over there. 99.8% Muslim. And you know what? What's the date over there? It's not a trick question. December 26th, 2015. That's what it is right now. In Muslim Afghanistan. Over in Thailand, it's 93.2% Buddhist. Guess what date it is over there in Thailand? What year is that? Yeah. And guess what? When this chick, Christine Snelska, when she walks into her office in Calgary today at the Atheist Alliance International, you know, the people that don't believe in anything, when she walks into her office over there in Calgary today, and she checked her email, and she looked at the bottom right-hand corner of her PC, guess what the date was in her atheist office? December 26, 2015, because every day is about Jesus. It's undeniable. Do you know the time is separated by there's two times. There's BC, which is what? Before Christ. And there's AD. Anyone know what that is? Not after death. Anno Domini. Anno Domini. It's a Latin term. What's it mean? In the year of the Lord. So the atheist, when that lady says it's December 26, 2015, it's in the year of the Lord. Busted. She's a Christian. She just doesn't know it yet. Yeah. It's coming. God's in charge of time. This revolution that he started, it's impacting every single person on earth. Matthew 16:18, one of my favorite verses in all of Scripture. First, we talked about God's book. We talked about God the person. We talked about God's time. Now let's talk about God's church. Has it made an impact in this world? Some people say yes. Some people say no. Let me give you some facts. You can make up your own mind. Well, here's the thing. 2,000 years ago, in a little city, I don't even call it a city, in Bethlehem, this little baby was born. Bethlehem is 6,545 miles from where we stand right now. 6,545. It was over 2,000 years. Who remembers what they had for lunch last Wednesday? Why has it got to be one in every service? They have to raise their hand. Okay, let's make it more difficult, Superman. Do you remember what you had for lunch 3 months ago on the second Tuesday of the month?
No, sir.
Okay.
Probably McDonald's.
Awesome. Okay. Well, Jesus, 2,000 years ago, to 12 people, how many people in this row? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Sorry, Zach. What are you laughing at? One of you is about to be Judas.
Not me.
That's what he said, too. Okay, so to just this group of people right here, this part-time carpenter and a part-time rabbi said to these people, 65, it says sounds better when I say it this way, 6,000 miles away from here, and one of them deserts him, so really 11. He says this, I will build my church and all the powers of hell will not conquer it. Amen. That's a crazy promise. Some might think that he's insane. But I'd like to share something with you. I told you that the church, the revolution has to be impacting and long-lasting for it to be called a revolution, to be significant, to say that it's been real. Well, I'd like to share something with you, and I don't have this thing memorized, so I'm just going to read it to you. But let me just see if his revolution has made an impact in this world. Let's just see if this Jesus is someone that we can trust when he says something. Remember, 6,500 miles. Okay, they don't have email. You can't Snapchat someone from Bethlehem 2,000 years ago to tell them the good news of Jesus. Okay? So approximately 2,015 years ago, Jesus Christ is born in Bethlehem in a barn with no ticker tape parade or fireworks, a part-time carpenter and rabbi, a bivocational teacher, tells 12 dudes his promise to build a family that will spread across the globe. But then he dies on a cross. Does the revolution end? Well, I'm sure a lot of people probably thought it would. But 3 days later, he resurrects from the dead. That's a good amen spot. And he ascends to heaven. But after that, he shows up 3 times, the scriptures say, just to tell people, hey, this is for real. This is for real. 50 days after his resurrection, the Holy Spirit that Jesus promised falls upon the 150 believers, and in power, the church of Jesus Christ is born. Being filled with that same Holy Spirit, Peter preaches the first church sermon, and 3,000 people that moment repent of their sin, turn to God, and are baptized and added to the church of Jesus Christ. In approximately AD 31 to 35, Stephen, after preaching Jesus, is stoned to death. Does this stop the revolution? No, as a matter of fact, history tells us that, and the Bible tells us that, about 3 years later, the supervisor of that stoning, Saul of Tarsus, is met by the resurrected Jesus as Saul was en route to Damascus to continue to try and kill and stop this revolution. And Jesus completely 180s this brutal killer's heart, and Saul becomes the great apostle Paul, who goes on 3 missionary journeys, preaching Jesus, planting 14 churches, and writing half of the New Testament that you have in your hand tonight. In AD 44, King Herod Agrippa I executes the apostle James, Jesus' brother, for preaching Jesus, and has Peter arrested. So we can sort of assume his fate, and does the revolution end there? No, it does not. Because in a moment of despair, nothing seems to be working. God sends an angel to release Peter from jail. Well, persecution increases for the church in Jerusalem, and the church of Jerusalem scatters to other nations. After Paul's last mission trip to Galatia and Ephesus, Paul spends 3 months in Greece, and then he returns to Jerusalem, where he is arrested for preaching Jesus. Now, on a ship en route to Rome to be tried for this treason, and surely he will die. His ship wrecks on the island of Malta on his way to Rome. When he finally gets to Rome, he lives there for 2 years, and Emperor Nero orders him to be beheaded. Well, this would surely end this revolution, would it not? I don't think so. In AD 80, Christianity spreads to France and Tunisia. In AD 100, Christianity spreads to Algeria and Sri Lanka. In AD 150, the gospel is preached and the revolution begins in Portugal and Morocco. AD 174, the gospel invades Austria, Switzerland, and Belgium. In AD 313, the Roman Empire, that was dead set on killing Jesus and killing this revolution, decrees, quote-unquote, tolerance for Christianity within the empire. In 328 AD, the revolution crosses the Ethiopian border, and this is crazy. In AD 380, the Roman Empire, that tried desperately to end Christianity, declares that Christianity is now the official religion of the Roman Empire. That's crazy. That's crazy. Almost 200 years go by, but the promise of Jesus to his 12 disciples continues. As Pope Gregory I sends Augustine to England to plant the church in England for the first time. And within 1 year, over 10,000 people turn from their sin, embrace Christ by faith, are baptized into the body of Christ in 1 year. In 635, the gospel reaches mainland China. In AD 740, the revolution grows to the shores of Iceland. And 160 years later, it finally hits Norway. By the year 1200, the Bible has been translated into 22 languages. In 1493, Pope Alexander VI commissions Catholic missionaries to accompany Christopher Columbus on his second journey to the Americas. Here comes Jesus. In the 1620s, pilgrims and Puritans settle the Massachusetts Bay Colony. And by 1630, just 10 years later, some 20,000 Protestant Puritans have moved from England to escape religious persecution to come here so they can worship Jesus freely. That's why they're here. Short time after that, in the year 1876, a group of Methodist believers under the direction and vision of Pastor Clark Pauley built the building that you sit in today. 6,045 miles away from where this promise was made 2,000 years ago, you sit in this building that Jesus built. And now, after that thing was built, 140 years later, 140 years later, because some crazy Jewish kid decided that he was going to let Jesus invade his heart, just the same Jesus that invaded Paul, and other people around him, parvus, decided that the life that they've been trying, any life they've ever attempted and failed at, was it paled in comparison to the life that Jesus Christ has offered them. And so was the birth of SNL Church. Okay? And out of nothing, this church was birthed. And God used this church through this crazy billboard that said, "Scumbags Welcome," to preach the good news of Jesus to 250 million people worldwide. It was crazy. And tonight, 6,500 miles away, and 2,000 years later, we gather as Revolution Church with identity and purpose. We are Christians, and we have been charged to preach the good news of Jesus to the ends of the earth, in Judea, to Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. That is what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to tell them about Jesus Christ, or else they will not know. So I ask you this. Did this revolution work out? I'd say it has. Well, tonight you're part of a movement that spans the globe and is 2.2 billion people strong. Just think of that. That's just the people that live now. Just think of that for a moment. 6,500 miles away from here, one man told 12 people that this was going to happen, and you're sitting in it. If you don't clap, you are crazy. That is insane. That is insane. That is insane. That blows me away. I can't describe to you the revolution in its entirety. If you've read the Bible at all, you know that pretty much everything that Jesus teaches is completely opposite of what you learn elsewhere. There's nothing normal about it. I just want to give you a couple little highlights to take with you so that you'll know Jesus is really good. And if the Christianity I'm about to describe to you is not the Christianity you've seen in people, can I just be the one to apologize on their behalf? They haven't represented our beautiful, loving Jesus well. Here's what the revolution looks like. Matthew 16:25. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. See, in a world that teaches us to better ourselves, to improve ourselves, to get ahead, to be on top, to take charge, to be control of your own destiny, Jesus is like, no, man, when I call you, I bid you to come and die. I don't want you to even live. There's nothing good inside of you. Let me give you a new way to live. Let me tell you something. That right there, there's only one book in the bookstore that teaches that. It's the Bible. It's not common. It's not accepted. Here's another one, Matthew 20. Go, do me a favor and go there with me. If you were wondering, like, is this guy ever going to get to the Bible? It's not like us normally. But Christmas isn't a normal day, and we're not a normal people. 20:25-27. Here's some more crazy stuff, man. Jesus calls together his disciples, and he says, "You know that the rulers in this world lord their power over their people, and officials flaunt their authority over those under them." Pause for a second. Anyone ever have a boss like that? Bless you. Anyone have a boss like that? Just mean. Rules with fear, intimidation. That's normal, right? Anyone ever been that boss? Yeah? But this is what Jesus says. "But among you, my brothers, my followers," so he's talking to you, "it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader among you must be your servant, like a slave. And whoever wants to be first among you must become your slave. And then the verse we spent a lot of time in last week, the week before. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others, and to give his life as a ransom for many. That's Jesus Christ. And that's the way we're supposed to live. Total upside down living. That is not what the world teaches, but that's what Jesus teaches in his revolution. Here's another one. John 13:34. Jesus says to his disciples to love one another as I have loved you. I don't want to spend a whole lot of time there, but think about that for a second. He had just washed their feet. He had cooked them food. Oh, and by the way, he died for them. He died so we could live. And Jesus is like, hey, everyone, listen to me. I want you to do that. That's what real Christians are supposed to be like. I fail at that miserably. We all do. But that's real, authentic Jesus. So if you're wondering if you should love Jesus and accept him as your Lord and Savior, but you're not sure about church, we'll work on the church thing. But Jesus, that's what Jesus is. You can freely love him because he freely loved you. Freely loved you. But here's the thing. It's easy to love one another. It's easy to love those that are similar to you, have the same views as you, that like the same things you like, the people that are in your life. It's easy to love them, but the revolution is quite different. Look in Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, verse 38. This is where it starts to get a little hard for people, but this is authentic Christianity. You ready? Are you there? You've heard the law that says the punishment must match the injury. And this is a famous one. An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. A lot of people still live by that. But Jesus always calls us to a higher level. He's never satisfied with this old law. He says, you've heard it said, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. But I say, do not resist an evil person. If someone slaps you on the right cheek, offer the other cheek too. If you are sued in court, and your shirt is taken from you, give your coat too. If a soldier demands that you carry his gear for a mile, in other words, like if he treats you poorly, just carry it 2 miles. Give to those who ask and don't turn away from those who want to borrow. Can we keep reading? You've heard the law that says, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Widely practiced lifestyle there. That's my addition. Verse 44, but I say, Jesus speaking, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you. In that way, you'll be acting, now this is huge. Pray for those that persecute you, and in that way, you'll be acting as true children of your Father in heaven. This is such a big deal that it appears in Luke as well. And I want to read it to you. It's brief, but I want to read it to you because I want you to get a full understanding of what Jesus is trying to teach us. New rules of the revolution. Luke 6:27. Very similar, but a different way of putting it. 27 through 31, and then verse 35. And this, I love this. But to you who are willing to listen, raise your hand if you're willing to listen to Jesus. You're making a statement here, okay? That's awesome, because not all people are. But to you who are willing to listen, I say, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Doesn't that hard right there? It's brutal. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who hurt you. If someone slaps you on one cheek, offer the other cheek also. If someone demands your coat, offer your shirt also. Give to anyone who asks, and when things are taken away from you, don't try to get them back. You did good. Do to others as you would like them to do to you. In this world of responsive reactions, this is what you've done, I do it back. That's not what Jesus calls us to. And of course, it's such a big deal that Paul just reiterates it over in Romans chapter 12. Guys in the church, we've been studying this for a while now. But Paul says this in Romans chapter 12, verses 14 through 20. Bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. Pray that God will bless them. Look at 17. Never pay back evil with more evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see you are honorable. Do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. Dear friends, never, say never.
Never.
Say never ever.
Never.
Yeah. Never take revenge. Leave that to the righteous anger of God. For the scriptures say, I will take revenge. I will pay them back, says the Lord. Instead, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. As he goes on, he uses this Bible expression of, if you do this, you'll heap burning coals of shame on their heads. In other words, what he's saying here is that the tool to win is to love them so much that they actually feel badly about what they've done to you. Not to reciprocate, evil for evil, bad for bad, you shoot me, I shoot you. No, you shoot me, I pray for you. God is, how many people have seen God's word come true in their life? Okay, so it works, right? It is true. If you want to see the most awful, evil person change, Paul the Apostle, me. Who else in this room is God's trophy of grace?
Amen.
A wretched, disgusting thing that he saved, right? If you want to see it, here's the recipe for success. You pray for those people. You pray for those people. You do good by them. You do good by them. Love. Love. Love is the reason for the incarnation of Jesus Christ. Love was the motivation for the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Love was the power behind the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And love is the weapon of the revolution of Jesus Christ. So in closing, I want to ask you, loved ones, will you revolt? Will you revolt? Will you be?
We will.
We will. Will you no longer allow the enemy of your soul and the system of the world that he's got set up to rule over you? Will you stand up and say no more to the enemy? Will you pursue a momentous shift in the status quo? Anyone ever seen War Room? I watched it the other night, guys. That lady, do you remember the lady? She says, devil, I don't know where you are, but I know you can hear me. Get out of my house! You know, kind of revolution we're talking about. Will you scream that at the top of your lungs? Will you tell the devil no more? Will you truly, honestly, listen, we've been saying this for 5 years. Open it, read it, and do it. Will you revolt against the system of the world? Will you finally stop taking the bait of Satan and live a righteous life that Jesus came to give you? Will you receive the call to repentance? Will you repent of your sins? Will you say, I don't want this one anymore. I want this life now. I don't know what I'm doing, and I need you to save me, and I need you to help me, and I need you to guide me. I want to do it your way, Jesus. I want to do it your way. Will you do like Paul said? Don't copy the behaviors and customs of this world, But let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Will you, listen, loved ones, look at me. Will you allow the creator of heaven and earth entrance into your mind? Will you do that once and for all? Will you no longer fake it? Will you no longer phone it in? Will you no longer have this veneer, this fake? Would you be authentic? Would you read the scriptures? Would you get on your knees? Would you cry out to God and say, change me? Would you do that? Would you do that? Would you do that? Will you revolt? Will you revolt? Will you be part of what God initiated 2,000 years ago when the baby was born, when the Savior arrived? Will you revolt? Let's pray. I need the guys to come up for communion. They're going to hand this out in a moment after we get done praying. We're going to give you a little time to make some decisions to revolt. Don't get up out of your seat. Don't go running off to the bathroom. You can hold it for another minute or two. Think of others as more important than yourself. Don't distract anybody. This is the time between you and the Creator. You've been told a lot of things tonight about some facts, about the impact that Jesus Christ has made on this earth. 6,545 miles from this place, one man over 2,000 years ago made a promise that included you in this building this night, that he would build his church and all the powers of hell would not conquer it. Now that's the Jesus I'm asking you to revolt with. That's the Jesus. He has proven himself before you this night. And as I'm asking you is, will you revolt? So these men are going to pass out communion, and then we're going to get together again. We're going to take it together as a family. Let's pray first. Father, we thank you. We thank you for this Christmas season. We thank you, Lord, for invading our space, for coming to save us when we couldn't save ourselves. Lord, we thank you for coming in the person of Jesus Christ, this child born in a stable, shows us how to serve, shows us how to take on the position of a slave, even the Son of Man, even Jesus Christ, the perfect Son of God, strapping on an apron, rolling up his sleeves to wait on people, to serve them, laying down his life so that we could have life. Thank you for that perfect example, Lord. Lord, would you change our perspective on Christmas? Would you get our minds out of the cornfield? Would you help us see up over the corn stalks to see the magnitude, the impact of your arrival here on this earth and what we are part of and what we've been called to? Help us to have a fresh new awareness of the reality that we are your sons and daughters, your ambassadors, making your plea through us. Would you give us a fresh desire to seek and save the lost just like you? Would you help us to live an abundant life that you came to deliver? Would you help us serve the way you serve? Lord, would you just help us not to copy the behaviors and customs of this world that lead to nothing but death and disappointment and despair. Help us to follow you. Give us a fresh new awareness of that spirit that you deposit in us, your spirit that raised Christ from the dead. Help us understand and literally feel it, Lord, inside of us. Help us to say yes when you ask. Help us to do when you say do. Help us to trust when you say trust. These gentlemen, keep your heads down. These gentlemen are going to pass communion out to you. It's going to come. They're going to hand it to someone. They're going to pass it next to them to you. So be aware of that. But once you receive the communion elements, we'll spend some quiet time so you and God can spend time together. So he can speak to you about how it is you're supposed to be a part of this revolution. What your job is. What your task is. What your role is in his revolution. And then we'll come back and take communion together.
Before you take communion, why don't you do me this favor? Put your
bread and your cup in one hand. This will allow you to encourage the family of believers that you're in right now. You ready? With your free hand, if during this quiet moment or sometime during this evening, if the Almighty has spoken to you, raise your hand. Look around you, everybody. See if he's alive. Look around. That's the God we worship here. years ago, he was born in a barn. He did a lot of things. But he had one sole goal. One goal. He was going to make his way to Jerusalem on purpose to go to that cross for you. And he would lay down his life so that you could live. To take your punishment. So don't take this communion like all sad. He's not sad. He did it joyfully. He did it happily. He loves you. So it's the time to celebrate. So look, with a smile on your face, a smile on your face that the world needs to see. Right, Robbie? Let's remember Jesus Christ going to the cross and putting his body on that cross for you. Take this to celebrate him. Hey, every good party needs a drink, right? So let's celebrate. Let's celebrate. Yeah, hold it up. L'chaim. Cheers to the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Take in remembrance of him. He's a good God. He's a good God. I love you. Listen, we have a chance to worship him right now. Don't run out of the room. You get a chance. Look at Robbie. He's up. Watch. Look at him. I don't even have to say anything. Up. Up, right? God's been good to you lately, hasn't he? He's been crazy good to this guy. Favor of the Lord all over his life. And he wants to do the same. Yes, you could do that. You clap. It's good. We have a chance to thank him for that. We have a chance to ask him for his favor. We have a chance to attribute value and worth to him right now. I don't know what we're singing, but we're singing. And so you get to sing to Jesus. I love you all. Merry Christmas.